Thank you very much. It's an enormous privilege to be here. I can't believe how pleased I am to come to this city, which I've heard about for such a long time. My Russian teacher was brought up in Tallinn in the 20s and 30s. She often spoke about it. And so I feel like coming to somewhere that I've got some contact with, connection with. When I got to take part in this conference, I was asked if I could develop something from the book that I wrote, that's just been referred to, the chapter in it on the image of God. And it occurred to me that one thing I might have to say, which might be of some use or helpful, is to say something about the way in which the Christian Church understands what it is to be human by thinking in terms of man being created in the image of God. In the book of Genesis, the first chapter, God creates the world. And until he gets to the creation of man, everything is created and complete. He creates by a word. He says, let there be light. Let there be the stars and the sun and the moon and the heavens. And it just happens. But when he gets to man, the tone changes. And the Lord, God considers what he is going to do. Let us make man in our own image and in our own likeness. And he makes man, but there's no comment that it was then complete. He makes man, and then we pass on to the rest, we then move into the rest of the book of Genesis. And what idea that you find in some of the fathers is that this is because when God created man, or created man and woman, he didn't complete what he had done. He left the completion of his creation to men and women themselves. In fact, one interpretation that is not very common in the fathers, but occasionally found in the fathers, is that the moment of completion of the creation of man and woman occurs on the cross, where the Lord says, it is finished. What is it that is finished? Not just his life. But what is finished is the creation of man and woman. If you remember in John's Gospel, where the Lord is depicted as saying, it is finished on the cross. This occurs in St. John's Gospel. And in St. John's Gospel, just before the crucifixion, Pilate presents the Lord to the people in the court and says, look, behold the man, behold the human being. And it is the completion of what God did at the beginning of creation that occurred on the cross. Now, I want to follow this through in various ways, not to be again, I haven't got much time. I want to say, start off by looking at what this might mean. In the account of the creation of man in the book of Genesis, it says, the Lord says, let us make man in our own image and in our likeness. And then he goes on to say, and the Lord made man and woman in his image. The second verse, the image and likeness. And many of the fathers interpreted this as meaning that God has created man in the image of God, and that this then had to be completed. That the likeness would be the fulfillment of what God had created. Whereas in the case of all the the animals, and the stars, and so on, they were created completely. In the case of man, man was left a task to fulfill what was meant by being in the image of God. What does it mean to be in the image of God? You find two strands, I think, in the Fathers. One, when they're thinking of human beings in relation to the rest of creation. And there they say that man is different from the rest of the created order because he has free will and because he has an intellect, intelligence. He is able to understand. And in this, human creation is distinct from animal creation, which hasn't got this capacity to understand, which hasn't got this capacity for freedom, to make something genuinely new. But human beings have. The word likeness in the Greek Bible, which is the one that the Church of Rome uses in its Bible, is a Greek word that conveys something rather different from the English word likeness. If we share in it as human beings, it's not a process that is just going to happen. There's an interesting hint of what this might mean in the German language. In the German language, the word for education is Bildung, and the word for image is Bild. And so the suggestion is, and I think it is actually a genuine suggestion and not a chance sort of occurrence, that what is meant by education is perfecting the image of God in ourselves. The use of the word Bildung in German, as I understand it, late medieval use, that is first found among the mystics, people like Eckhart and others. And for them, it means the process of completing the work that God did, started when he created man in his image. Now what does this process entail? There seem to be two ways in which one can sort of look at this. And they both converge. One is simply to look at what it was that man was intended to do by God when he created him. God created man in his image. The rest of the created order is not in his image, or not said to be in his image. But man is specifically said to exist in the image of God. And I think this means at least two things. It first of all means that there is a light, there is a similarity, there is something, there is some sort of kinship between God and man. I think a better way of putting it would be to say that the image of God and man means that we are created to have a relationship with God. That we fulfill what we are by being human beings, insofar as we develop this relationship with God. And we have this relationship because God has given us a likeness to him. There is something in common. Even though God is the creator and we are created out of nothing, nevertheless, God has created us so that there is something in common between us and him. And this something in common is being in the image, being able to relate to God. Ultimately, I think, being able to pray, which is why I think there's no chance that in the German language, the first meaning of Bildung is used in relationship to the mystic quest, the attempt by human beings to search out God and find him and find union with him. The other side, I think, is this, and go back to what I suggested originally. that the process of making man is something that was only complete on the cross. Why? Well, the most obvious because of the fall. The story in Genesis moves on in chapters 2 and 3 to tell the fall of Adam. And then in the chapters that see that, it talks about the creation of a human society which is moving further and further and further away from God. And ends that part of the Genesis in chapter 11 with the story of the Tower of Babel, when humans, as it were, attempt to storm heaven, and God frustrates them by making lots of different languages so that there is confusion and lack of ability to relate and to understand. And because of that, the process of the creation of humanity was never complete. And it was only finally completed when the image itself, Christ himself, described in the Bible in the New Testament as being the image of God, comes and completes the work that had been done in the moment of creation, at the beginning of creation, but completes it on the cross. For what had to be done by then was make good all the evil and harm that had been brought into the life of humanity by fallen human beings. And so, the process of achieving the likeness that God intended for us is a process that is now not just a simple growth to maturity, as very conceivably would have happened if Adam had not fallen. He would have grown in the garden, he would have begun to understand and appreciate the goodness of God's creation, and ultimately would have reached the state of being in the likeness as well as being in the image. But this didn't happen. And the whole root of humanity, as it were, moved through history, through the history of brokenness, of wars, of opposition of human being to human being, all of which had to be knitted together. And this was something that was beyond the human capacity. And so it is only in Christ, in whom everything is held together, that eventually we see what it is to be man. And we see this on the cross. We see it on the cross because the cross is the image of that kind of love that human beings were meant to grow into. It is only on the cross that we see the kind of love that was intended to fulfill the image within us. The kind of love that will turn the image into the likeness of God, so that we will see in one another's faces not just another human being, but we'll see someone in whom radiates the love of God. And so the process of education is not just a matter of bringing up children. It is a process of moving from where we are, fallen, images of God that are broken, moving from that to the fulfillment of the likeness that God intended when he created Adam. There's another aspect, perhaps is worth mentioning here too. When the fathers think of what it is to be human, they are often both immensely realistic and also enormously idealistic. They are realistic in that they see human beings as animals. That our makeup passions, our desires, our longings, all of them can be traced back to the animal components that we are made. That we are made from. It always seems to me that had anybody thought of the notion of evolution in the 4th century, the fathers would have found it very easy to accept, because their sense of what human beings and what the animal world have in common is very profound. But that's not the end of the story. It is also the case that when the fathers look at the human, they see him in enormously idealistic terms, with great potential. And one of the ways in which they put this is by saying that the human being is placed on a frontier between the animal world, which is created, an animal world which we, if we turn towards, will in the end swallow us up. And we ourselves become like animals, or actually really wrong, worse than that, because what we will make of animal potentialities is something which is, can be really wrong, terrifying. Gregory of Nyssa, for instance, at one point, gives a list of examples of the ways in which animals behave and what this looks like when it becomes a human. He talks about the proud bearing of the horse, which is part of what it is to be a horse. But when the human being adopts this proud bearing, it becomes something destructive. The human being is placed on the frontier between the animal world and the divine world. And at this frontier, he can either turn back or turn forward. If he turns back towards the animal world, then we have the history of humanity as we know it. A world that is at odds with itself. A world in which human beings come close to destroying one another. But if the human turns towards the divine, then the human is able to exercise, in relation to the rest of the created order, a role that is very like that of God. A role in which he takes responsibility for the created order to which he belongs, and attempts to turn this created order back to God, to offer it to him as something fine and beautiful. But this is a process that is very hard. It's a process that almost the whole of human history is moving against. It's a process that, in the last few centuries, human discoveries, which I feel like are an aspect of the nobility of man, the advance of science, the advance of technology, all of these things that in themselves are good, and are evidence of the divine quality in man, left to themselves become destructive, and destructive of the human, of the created order that we as human beings have been given as something to care for, something to nourish, something to preserve. And so, if we just simply look at what how the fathers interpret this understanding of man being in the image and reaching out towards the likeness of God, being an image that, as it were, has been placed on the animal world so that we are completely continuous with the animal world, that we have exactly the same characteristics, but that we are meant to perfect the creation so that the movement from the image of God to the likeness of God is not a purely individual thing, but is concerned with our completing the work of creation that God began. And then, amazingly, this created order was left in our hands. And so the doctrine of the image recalls us to the promise that human beings have recall us to what human beings can be capable of. But all of these things double-edged. Human beings are capable of very great things. But these great things can be terrifying, or they can be human. And the image that I started off with, of creation of man being completed on the cross when the Lord cried out, "It is finished," and finished his human life. That image is the image that we must keep at the centre of our understanding of what it is to perfect the image of God in ourselves. The image of God in ourselves is perfected to the extent that we displayed our own lives, the kind of love that we see a picture of